Steve Outtrim, welcome to the Gnostic Media Podcast.
Thanks very much for having me, Jan. Really honored to be here.
And I'm excited to have you on. This is a very important topic. You and I have been discussing doing a show on this topic, which is Burning Man and the whole surrounding culture, for about the last 6 or 8 months. And you and I have both been doing parallel research, looking at the same mountain essentially from different sides. And so anyway, I'm happy to have you here. Would you like to start off by telling the audience a little bit about yourself and your background?
Sure. Thanks very much. So I kind of have an unusual background to be talking about sort of topics on Gnostic media. I'm an amateur historian, and I'm actually an internet tech guy. I got a degree in business in New Zealand and started an internet company pretty young. I took it public as the CEO when I was 23 and broke a record that Rupert Murdoch had held in Australia for about 40 years. That's to be the youngest CEO of a publicly listed company. My product called Hot Dog was a web authoring tool. So in the early days of the internet and the World Wide Web, 1995 until 2000, we had one of the most popular pieces of software out there. It was actually named the number 3 most downloaded software on the internet by Wired magazine in 1997. I first went to Burning Man in 1998. I've been there 11 times, and I've also been to one of their regional burns. And I've seen Burning Man change a great deal in that time. And I've also seen San Francisco and the tech industry itself change a great deal in that time. And recently, Elon Musk was quoted as saying that Burning Man is Silicon Valley. And if you want to understand Silicon Valley, you really need to go to Burning Man. And that wasn't always the case, I don't think. But as you look at, as time has passed and as Burning Man has got bigger and bigger and more important and significant, it's merged a lot tighter with the tech industry as well. And I guess that's some of the things that we'll be going into today.
Excellent. Well, where should we begin? I know this is a deep topic and we've got a lot to cover. So do you want to share screens now and we'll go into the slides?
Sure, let's do that.
All right, great. All right, there we are.
That came up?
Yep, that came up.
How this story began was I wanted to promote my tech companies using social media, Facebook and Twitter. I talked to my team in Australia, and they didn't really think that was very corporate. So I decided to start something new to kind of learn about this new world of blogging and social media. I started a website that's called burners.me in 2012, about Burning Man, but also the culture of burners, which has outgrown Burning Man and is spreading around the world. We've become the largest unofficial burner community, and I'm just sharing with the audience here some of the stats. This is the most popular Facebook post we ever did. This is what it looks like when a post truly goes viral. It was viewed by 22.2 million people. It was shared 378,000 times, and it got 209,000 likes. On the bottom right of the screen there is our best week so far this year on Facebook, where we reached 3.7 million people in a week. Our best day on WordPress was 602,000 people in a day. And the bottom two images on the left and the center there, we've a couple of times now been the most popular blog in the world and also the most popular blogging story in the world out of about 38 million blogs on WordPress. So I mention that just to say that I'm not some random internet troll that, you know, wants to complain about Burning Man because I don't like it or I have a grudge against them. I love Burning Man. I think Burning Man is great. I think everyone should go. I think you should go, Jan. I think you'd enjoy it.
Well, I'm not in any one of those groups or cells or whatever they're called, you know?
Well, not yet. But, probably wouldn't take.
Maybe I can be in one of the millionaire tech groups.
But look, no. I would recommend for everybody to go to Burning Man and see it for yourself. It's a lot of things to a lot of people, but one of the things that is a large part of Burning Man, as you get to study their organization, is propaganda. And they're probably the first organization since the Nazis to employ a minister of propaganda. That's an actual title. The last one recently left. I'm not sure if they're going to replace him or not, but there have been at least two different people in the role of Minister of Propaganda at Burning Man for many, many years. And so what I've been doing in my blog is a lot of their claims, I've been fact-checking them. And they make some quite outrageous claims, and some of them really haven't stood up to the kind of scrutiny that the trivia method provides. And in particular, I was watching an interview in 2013 with Burning Man founder Larry Harvey and John Perry Barlow, lyricist from the Grateful Dead, founder of the EFF. And this had happened after a conference in London called Le Web, which is like a tech media cultural conference. But it was also the same time that Google and the Bilderberg Group were having their annual meeting together. And in this interview, Larry Harvey made some really, I thought, quite outrageous and astonishing claims. And one of them was that Burning Man started in a garage at the same time that Google started in a garage. And we'll delve into that a little bit more in this presentation, but Burning Man started in 1986 and Google started in 1998. And that really isn't the same time. And if you look at what happened in the tech industry between 86 and 98, it would be hard to get those two eras confused.
Well, Steve, you know, you've got to have the hero's journey that you're going to tell the public to, you know, want them to follow along with your propaganda.
Yes. Well, so I guess maybe this is the beginning of my journey where I left my ordinary world behind to explore the adventures with this new band of comrades in arms and everything. But anyway, looking at this interview, and I've got a little clip from it that we could show in a second, but I was really confused, and I started writing a story debunking what he'd said. And something twigged in the back of my mind that I thought I'd seen on the internet once, something about the Grateful Dead having ties to the CIA. And so I went to Google and I typed in Grateful Dead CIA, and sure enough, your name came up. that led to me reading Manufacturing the Deadhead, an absolutely fantastic, fantastic article. And before I even got to the end of it, I was just like, this is exactly like Burning Man. And went away to start writing about that. Returned later to finish the article, and I saw that actually at the end you had made that point yourself. So, yeah, I mean it's amazing, and I think a broader point really is how Burning Man is so similar to the '60s counterculture in San Francisco. These hippies, they believed in peace and love and hugs, free love, free drugs, and that was going to bring about, you know, an end to wars and violence and make the world a better place. And now those hippies have grown up, and that Grateful Deadhead generation are judges and lawyers and bankers and doctors, kind of the mainstream of society. And the kids today rebelling, certainly in San Francisco, these burners think they're going to Burning Man and they're saving the world. And that just by, you know, peace and love and hugs and all of that stuff, it's the same, you know, ideas all over again. And when we look behind it, we'll find the same people, the same organizations, and as you pointed out, the same frameworks. So let's go to that clip.
Back in the point in the 90s, around 96, 97, suddenly folks from Silicon Valley began to become in droves. You know, famously, the Google guys were out. We started in a garage about the same time they started in a garage.
Oh, you had them beat.
And there are things in common. You know, their project.
Not sure how many parts this is going to be, but let's begin at the beginning. Part one. It's the earliest known photograph of San Francisco to the left there from 1850. And you'll notice all the masts in the background from all of the ships. People would come from Panama and Nicaragua seeking their fortune, mining and gold. Many of the ships would never return and were just abandoned in San Francisco because there wasn't any passengers or cargo to pay for a voyage back. On the right there is the first ever Apple computer for sale for $666.66, a nice occult price tag. And you had to supply your own tape recorder and your own TV screen. So we've come a long way from then. San Francisco is a 49-square-mile circus in search of a tent. And all of the burners are in search of their tents as well. The area on the peninsula where it says the city, that's a 7-by-7-square-mile kind of grid that San Francisco exists in. Silicon Valley is really down to the south where San Jose is, but the area between the city and Silicon Valley is essentially where most of the tech companies are. Tech is booming right now so much that it's now spreading out the eastern side of the bay as well. So Freakmont over there, you'll see the town, Berserkly. This is obviously the Urban Dictionary guide map, but kind of amusing and really quite descriptive. And if you zoom in on SF, you'll see LSD and Gay Mecca, and that's where the Burning Man headquarters is located. I just want to read you this quote from the left about the gold rush. Despite the amazingly high cost of living and the extraordinary opportunities for frittering away money, everyone in early San Francisco was supremely confident that he would soon be able to return home with an incalculable amount of gold. Everything was conceived on a vast scale, and there was always plenty of cash available for any scheme that might be proposed, no matter how impossible or bizarre it seemed. And so San Francisco, that's what it was like between 1847 and 1855. It was really no different in the 60s, and it's really no different today. So you can't necessarily blame the tech industry or accredit the tech industry for the boom. Maybe there was something in the water, or maybe there was Century Club, Bohemian Grove, Skull and Bones, some of those people around in California from the very, very beginning driving all of these booms. This next slide is using an image from Silicon Valley maps. And so the tech companies that are shown in this map are probably the ones who paid them for sponsorship. It's not perfectly representative of the valley, for example, where Facebook and Yahoo are located should probably be swapped around. But a couple of key points here is, you know, if California was its own country, you may have heard it would be the 8th largest economy in the world. But if San Francisco was its own country, it would be the 19th largest economy in the world. And we have a GDP per capita of just about $75,000, which is number one in the U.S. It's actually not enough to live in Palo Alto. They just recently announced that they're going to be providing housing assistance for families living on less than $250,000 a year. And people thought that was the onion, but that's not the onion. That's serious discussion in Palo Alto right now. And so what that's been meaning is that there's a drive out of the center of that, the map, center of Silicon Valley, and up towards the city and out towards Oakland, where the housing's a bit more affordable and where the young people are. Silicon Valley itself is becoming a lot more family-oriented, but the cool, edgy tech companies, they don't really want to go for that. We have 92 of the Forbes 500, we have 34 of the Fortune 500, and we have 49 of the world's billionaires. Not all of them in tech, by the way, but it's certainly the main driver of the economy in Silicon Valley. But what's the main driver of technology? Well, we live in a military-dominated world. Love this cartoon. The little kid's asking, why do we have wars? Mommy says, because we're ruled by an elite group of psychopaths who own the banks that control the governments and media. They fund both sides of war for profit. They manufacture the consent of the public through the propaganda of the media. Now, I don't think this will be anything new to your audience, Jan. I think we're all very aware of this propaganda and the manufacturing of consent and this Hegelian dialectic that to get the situation they want, they fund the opposite sides of the same problem. With the idea that, you know, the resolution will be towards the center. And this is still very, very much going on today. I think we could see it in the current election.
Sure. Well, thesis, antithesis, synthesis.
Absolutely. So we live in a military-dominated world. Looking at just the most recent U.S. budget, discretionary spending, military is 54%. Okay, we hear a lot about healthcare, 6%, education, 6%. But military is by far what the government of the United States spends its money on.
But wait a second, Steve. Obama's president.
Yeah, Nobel Peace Prize winning Obama.
Yeah, he did nothing to win that, but yeah.
Yeah, well, he certainly has a lot of collateral damage on his hands for such a peace-loving guy. But if you contrast our military budget to the Russians, recently were able to defeat ISIS in Syria, they're spending a fraction of what we're spending, and they're able to get results. We actually spend 55% of the whole world's military budget. And it's more than the next 10 countries combined, much more than we spend on anything else. So this is a heavily militarized society just from following the numbers. So why don't we see it then? Well, the main thing is that military bases aren't located where civilian populations are located. So in the United States, 80% of the population are in urban areas. But the bases are far away, and many of them are deep underground, at least 132 in the US. That's what we know about. And if you're a civilian driving past these massive bases, you really can't see much past the secure fences. I've got an image at the bottom left there that's recent from just basically surplus equipment in an army depot in California. This equipment is brand new. It has never been used and never been deployed. And it's just row upon row upon row of this. Now, we don't normally see this stuff in our everyday life driving around, but think about the money that is just sitting in that
pocket. Yeah, that looks an hour or two from here.
Right, yeah. And, you know, the wars are offshore, particularly in the United States, so we're kind of removed from the effects of it, and particularly by the increasing use of drones for military operations. Also, there have been previously restrictions on the military doing anything domestically within the U.S. That's been rescinded under the National Defense Authorization Act. But it's still, you know, the ethos of the military is not to do things domestically. So out of sight, out of mind. And then we get to the entire intelligence apparatus, which is buried deep underground. It's watching us from the space. It's probably listening to us right now. And it's plugged in. Hi, everyone. And it's plugged into the artificial intelligence. So what does it know? What does it think? What is it learning? We don't know. And quite possibly even the people that program these systems to feed the data in don't even know what it knows and what it thinks and what it's learning. Internet and cell phones everywhere. We all have supercomputers that we carry around with us. The system that they're plugged into knows where we are and knows our voice patterns. And what we see when we look at the screen is data that's presented to us, but what we never see is what's on the other side of that screen. And you can guarantee that any time you see a screen, not only are there corporations looking back at you from behind the screen, but there are government and intelligence agencies as well. Moving on from that, specifically drilling in, that the Pentagon is one of the world's biggest landowners, and I think not many people would realize that. The biggest landowner on the earth is Queen Elizabeth and the Crown of England, who has basically 1/6 of all of the land on the planet belongs to this person. The Pope has comes number 3 in the list of landowners, but if the Pentagon's 24.9 million acres were in the list, by size that would make them number 8 in land in the world. They have almost 300,000 buildings with over $500 billion of value on 4,855 sites. So they're absolutely one of the world's biggest landowners. We've got 1.3 million troops. We have 5,000 bases, most of them domestically, but we have foreign bases in more than 800 countries. Sorry, we have more than 800 foreign bases in other countries. And if you combine Britain, France, and Russia, that's only 30 foreign bases. So we love to think of America and the flag and the national anthem and baseball and apple pie. But really, the country that we're living in is heavily militarized and focused on the global projection of that power. So military is key to everything. In 2015, Sergei Glazyev, who's an advisor to President Putin, he said that Moscow must gain control of its central bank. preventing speculators to move their credit around for non-productive purposes, such as George Soros breaking the pound and things like that. Moscow should also establish currency controls and must create a central organization of technological research to replace the loss of Western technology. Now, here's the key bit. Imitating the US methodology of rolling out from its centralized military research those technologies that can be commercialized for the consumer market. So the US methodology, what drives our economy and our technology, is that we develop the technology and centralized military research. And then we roll it out through universities and commercial companies for the consumer market. That's what Silicon Valley is all about. It's not really about creating the technology, because most of the technology in Silicon Valley has come from somewhere else. Silicon Valley popularizes it and brings it out to everybody else. And here in Silicon Valley, we don't just create technology, we create culture as well. And the culture creates the context for the technologies. And there, I think, has been a relationship between science fiction and engineering, invention, and the technocracy going back at least 100 plus years, where perhaps the science fiction's describing classified military research, perhaps it's there to create the consumer demand, perhaps it's being seeded by the bankers to see what things are going to fly from the proposals on their desk. But there's been an uncanny link between things predicted in sci-fi that, you know, later we're dealing with it and have in everyday life.
And things like H.G. Wells' The Invisible Man and The Time Machine and, of, you know, all of these ideas are what fed into the start of all of this, and then Aldous Huxley taking over from the 30s onward.
Yeah, and if you were to just look at any one of those authors' works in isolation, you would think, gee, H.G. Wells, what an incredible genius. He thought of all of these things. Huxley, how prescient was he? He predicted this to a T. But when you actually do as you've done and as I've done, and do the research and look into who these people were and who they knew and their relationships with each other and with secret societies and with intelligence agencies, it suddenly becomes pretty obvious how they got all of this information and managed to be, you know, so accurate and on track with the plans. It's because they had those plans, and in most of the cases were the ones writing those plans at the same time as they were writing the novels.
Absolutely correct.
So let's move on from this concept of centralized military research, which I think even most of the people that I have talked to in 20 years of working in Silicon Valley, they don't really realize that that's how this is working, that this technology, most of it's come from the military first. But we'll take something we're all familiar with, the iPhone. Amazing image here from Banksy. I'm a huge fan of the graffiti artist Banksy. This is called Modern Prison, and he actually has incorporated some of the elements of the panopticon prison concept in his rendering of this iPhone. One of the key things inside the modern iPhone is Siri, and Siri is actually named after SRI, which used to be called the Stanford Research Institute. They were basically kicked out by student protesters and are now independent and are known as SRI International. But they undertook the largest artificial intelligence project in United States history. And, you know, if it's the biggest one our military has ever done, I'd say it's the biggest one that's ever been undertaken in the world by anyone. And that was to create Siri. And they spun the technology out into a private company that still licensed it back to the Department of Defense. That company went through a few rounds of venture capital financing, and then it was bought by Apple. And Siri was absorbed into Apple and then deployed onto every single iPhone, and now it's being rolled out into TV and into cars. If you ask Siri, are you always listening? It's quite you get an interesting answer. But I really don't believe everything Siri tells me, whether I ask it if it's listening or not. Yeah, Siri's always listening. And not only is it always listening, but it is listening to your voice prints and perfectly understanding your voice prints. So that's a biometric signature, which means if any computer connected to the internet hears your voice through any sensor anywhere in the world, the artificial intelligences can identify that that's you. So any microphone in the world can now be used to track your motion simply by the artificial intelligence knowing your voice print. That's probably a consequence of Siri. I'm not sure that's the main purpose of developing it. But this graph here from Business Insider shows that many of the other components inside the iPhone as well, such as GPS, multi-touch screen, click wheel, lithium-ion batteries, signal compression. These are coming out of Department of Defense projects. They're coming out of Department of Energy projects for out of DARPA classified research. And in very many cases, the technology that doesn't come directly from these organizations, the one that comes from commercial technologies, it still has been licensed and financed by big government or military purchases as, you know, the thing that got, you know, that created the business case for the company to go into production for that device. And we'll delve into that a little bit later as well. So the results of the government creating all of this amazing technology is that these tech companies have more cash than actual countries. Now, these numbers change around, obviously, as the market capitalizations go up and down. And briefly this year, Google did beat Apple as the world's most valuable company. The last I looked, Apple was back on top. And so I've looked at their peak market capitalizations, which for Apple is $764 billion, on track to be the first trillion. They've got $750 billion. Google has just over $500 billion, peak cap of $527 billion. Now, that's what the shares are worth, but this table here is showing the cash that these guys have in the bank. It's a little old. Apple's latest quarter reporting was $203 billion cash reserves. But even here, they have more cash reserves than any country in the world. And almost entirely this money is offshore outside of the tax system. But you'll see here the United States is at 21, and they have 48 billion. Cisco Systems is at 22 with 47 billion. So we're creating companies funded by our military that have more money sitting in the bank offshore away from taxes than entire countries do.
Well, it's very interesting. You see countries like Colombia, et cetera, it's number 27 there. And right. Here, you know, Colombia is supposed to be this poor country, but yet obviously they're quite wealthy.
Enormous cash reserves, yeah. I mean, I've been to Colombia. It's a beautiful country. I would recommend for people to visit it. And, yeah, they do have a lot of industrial production compared to some of the South American countries, but there's somewhere like Qatar, for example. I've also been there, and that's a tiny, tiny little island. They just happen to be on top of the largest natural gas reserves in the world, and very close to where the US likes to locate its strategic bases. So they get to play with the big boys here. Anyway, the result from having so much of this business offshore is that we have a shadow economy, and I just want to touch on this a little bit because I'm calling my thing shadow history. And I think any student of history will tell you that history gets written by the victors, and what really happened is almost never the official story. And it's the same thing when it comes to the economy. When the president stands up and talks about the economy, they pretend that the shadow economy doesn't exist. But for those of us living in the real world, we understand that there are people who get paid in cash. There are people that do illegal things and don't declare it to the government. There are corrupt government officials that siphon money away. And the reality is this is actually a very large and very significant part of our economy. It's foolish to ignore it. The Fortune 500 companies have got $2.1 trillion offshore. It's growing at 8% a year. We got a national debt of $19 trillion. So you know, that's like a significant amount of money. 72% of the Fortune 500 operate tax haven subsidiaries, 7,600 of them. The top five tech companies have about $500 billion of cash offshore. We have about 18 and 19% of income in the US doesn't get reported to the IRS. In California, the shadow economy is 15 to 17% of the labor force, estimated somewhere between 60 to 140 billion a year of lost revenue to the state if that was taxed. And the average size of it in developing countries is 13% in developed countries, 36% in developing countries. UK is pretty good, 10%. Italy, 20%. The size of the shadow economy in Italy is larger than the entire economy of Austria. And about half of the banknotes in the UK are used for this shadow economy. And so here's just a ranking of the companies that are the worst offenders for keeping their cash offshore. Apple, absolutely number one. They've got people in China working in sweatshops, jumping off factories and killing themselves. And on the other end of the stack, they've just got the world's biggest pile of cash completely outside of the tax system. And they can get away with it and be called America's greatest company. I don't know. I love Apple, but I don't agree with that, you know. Drop the prices at least.
Most of, not most, I'm kidding, 99%+ of all of my tech support is for Mac and Mac users. We've had one PC tech support call in 6 years.
It might be because nobody uses PCs anymore. Yeah.
I don't know about that. They're still dominant. I think, you know,
everyone's on iPads.
Well, you know, it's just people pay three times more for a computer that they still don't learn how to use. I think that's the main issue. You know, there's a very good marketing strategy, but unfortunately. Absolutely. Unfortunately, the people are no more competent to use them.
Yeah, and I think that's by design as well. They're trying to dumb us down.
It absolutely. Well, and, you know, being a former network engineer myself, you know, I saw this with Apple's whole promotion. You know, once they came out with the iPad, their whole direction was dumbing down the IT industry, getting rid of any extra buttons, menus, anything that provided user control. That was their goal. And, in fact, several years ago I saw this lecture, this guy, I can't remember his name, out in L.A., but his whole thing was, get rid of this, get rid of that, get rid of this, get rid of that. And it's like, wait, that's the stuff I like, you know.
Yeah, look, I think a really key point behind all of that is the shift to the cloud. And technology has sort of gone in a few cycles of data center, home computer, data center, home device. Right now we're in the data center cycle, but I'm not sure we're ever going to come back. I really see the use of the personal computer being de-emphasized because they really, really, really want everyone to put their data in the cloud. When it's in the cloud, it's much easier for other people to get it, to look at it, to analyze it.
Well, you know, and that was the whole point. Well, with the iPhone, of course, what you saw was Steve Jobs and Apple putting these tiny little memory chips that cost $3 and then charging $100 for each additional 16 gigabytes of space. And the whole goal of that, whereas your Samsungs and your other phones, you just, you know, take a little SD chip and you plug it in and, oh, look, I've got 120 more gigs of space. But that was the whole goal of that, was to drive people to use this cloud space rather than their own storage.
Definitely. And I just yesterday was watching an interview with John McAfee, who was saying he always removes the battery from his cell phone if he wants to talk about anything sensitive. And, of course, you can't do that with the Apple products.
Well, and I mean, that's another reason why I don't buy Apple products, is you can't take out the battery, you can't just pop in a new micro SD chip, etc.
Well, let's move on, and we're definitely going to come back to Apple a little bit later on.
All right.
So as well as the shadow economy, we have a shadow government, and we live in an oligarchy. It's no longer just me saying that. That's a Princeton and Northwestern study called Testing Theories of American Politics, Elites, Interest Groups, and Average Citizens. So they've gone out and they've compared 1,800 different policies from 1981 to 2002. And they've gone and looked at what did the people prefer, what did wealthy people prefer, and what did special interest groups prefer. And then they looked at how often did things come out on the side of the people and how often did things come out on the side of the special interest groups. And I'm sure it's no surprise really to anybody actually living in this country, but sure enough, the central point that emerges from our research is that economic elites and organized groups representing business interests have substantial independent impacts on U.S. government policy, while mass-based interest groups and average citizens have little or no independent influences. When a majority of citizens disagrees with economic elites and or with organized interests, they generally lose. And so the net result of that is that, we're living in an oligarchy, a capitalistic oligarchy, and extremely wealthy people can have an undue influence over the society. And this is not the original idea of democracy or even a democratic republic. If you look at Wall Street donations, I've got a chart there for the previous election cycle, 2012 to 2014. And the largest donor is from the Bay Area, Thomas Stryer. His donation was so much larger than everybody else that they had to put that gray bar there on the chart, just for proportional reasons, $176 million. But it's absolutely put to shame by the Koch brothers' budget for just this year for the election is $880 million. And that's not the operating budget for their business empire. That's their political spending budget. So, I don't think it's right that money should have that much influence over the world. And I also don't think it's right that technology should have so much influence over the world. I actually think that the founding fathers of America, you know, had really thought long and hard about world history and tyranny and oppression. And there were some fantastic ideas in the original, you know, constitution of this country. And it does seem that we're drifting in a different direction. Perhaps even that we have been taken over by the banking cartels and, through the use of propaganda and war and electronic distractions, are basically getting away with anything they want because people don't have the will to fight anymore.
All right. You wanted to get into your definitions?
Yeah. So I just want to breeze through some definitions that are going to relate particularly to what we're talking about. So the word occult, of or relating to magic, astrology, or any system claiming use or knowledge of secret or supernatural powers or agencies. Okay, so any system using secret agencies is a cult. And in fact, when you look at the history of modern secret agencies, intelligence agencies, and the elite and the cult, you find an incredible intersection that really hasn't gone away. It's still there today. It never left. And why should it leave? Because the word means the same thing. And it basically came to us in the late 1400s, maybe even early 1500s, just in time for John Dee to appear to be the Queen's astrologer. But anything that's hidden, anything that's secret is a cult. So,
Let me just ask you, wasn't John Dee a major influence on Terence McKenna? And John Dee was a big agent like Emanuel Swedenborg and all these other guys, Asani Sabah, etc.
In the 1580s of the 16th century, it was in this period that the English astrologer, astronomer, mathematician, navigator, and expert of espionage, John Dee, launched his famous and mysterious mission to Bohemia.
Yeah, I think John Dee was sort of kind of the Merlin to Queen Elizabeth. I think there's a long tradition of having these sages and advisors, the magical priest whispering in the king's ear, who has access to knowledge and intelligence that the royal family doesn't. And there actually were schools where these Merlins, these sages, were sent, the ancient mystery schools, and they learn much of the same knowledge. And so you can look at a lot of the different figures from history that played these roles did appear to have the same knowledge. And, you know, their way of thinking seems to be very aligned with these ancient teachings of the mystery schools. We'll move on to scientists. I've got a great quote here from Carl Sagan. It's suicidal to create a society dependent on science and technology in which hardly anybody knows anything about the science and technology. And that's the great danger. That's where we're hurtling headlong into this technological world, and most people really don't understand at all how it works or what it means. A scientist, it's a person who's studying or has expert knowledge of one or more of the natural or physical sciences. And it came to us in 1834, this word. So, you know, we haven't had scientists for a very long time, even though maybe we've had science. But in the days of Sir Isaac Newton, these guys were occultists. They were trying to infer the magical and occult principles of the universe. The experiments they were doing were around things like alchemy. Newton wouldn't consider himself a scientist. The word did not exist until 1834. Reverend William Whewell, who coined it, he was coining it by analogy with artist, and he also coined the term physicist. So, yeah, an artist deals with the arts, a physicist deals with physics and mechanics, and the scientist deals with science and knowledge and observation and experimentation. Coming out of scientist, we have scientism, and scientism, I think, is a very dangerous and insidious thing. It's the idea that science is all-powerful and all-encompassing, and that if there's ever an issue between something that's morally correct and something that's scientifically correct, science should always win. There are two problems with that. One of them is morality and ethics, which I don't think we have time to get into, but the other one is that science itself can't explain everything. And so when you follow science towards the frontiers and the cutting edge, you get argument amongst scientists. And the smartest people in the world can't say every single thing there is about science. And so in that case, actually, why should it be in charge if it's not a perfect system? You know, if we're going to have an imperfect system in charge, what's so great about science that that should be the system? But scientism has been pushed very, very hard on us. That's the core of technocracy. Certainly the trivium method gives you the context to you know, be able to make intelligent decisions, but that isn't being taught to scientists.
Well, and that's exactly right. There's this big vacuum of critical thinking there, and you have all of these different agendas being played out at the same time, and when I look at a lot of scientific research and I really dig into it as a primary fact checker, I find all kinds of errors and lies and omissions and things like that, which are geared to drive studies and outcomes towards someone's agenda or given conclusion. And because of this, science is not accurate. I mean, you know, the CIA and the ethnobotanist, for instance, which was intended to be a scientific study originally with psychedelics and hallucinogenic drugs, but all of the data, unless you're maybe one of those on the end, and half of the agents that I've exposed don't even know half of this stuff, but if they don't know that the whole field is co-opted and corrupted, then any forthcoming science from there, quote unquote, without going back and checking all of the primary citations, is going to be wrong. So what you have is, you know, hundreds of books, thousands of books being published that are based on complete nonsense. You know, quantum physics is a perfect example of that.
Absolutely. Or another great one is that they had to change the name of global warming to climate change.
Absolutely.
Because the grammar doesn't work anymore, therefore alter the rhetoric.
Well, you know, when I was a boy in the 70s, we were supposed to be in an ice age by now, right?
So, and then just to finish off on the definitions of this slide, the etymology of government comes from gubernatio mentis, or mind control. It's like
right. Government. And a lot of people are going to argue on that, Steve. And I've had philologists contact me and raise hell about that. And I followed the philology all the way through and actually disproved them. And one of the Clint Richardson episodes down in the notes. I forget, he's been on the show like 8 or 10 times, but down in the notes below the show is a whole layout for those of you who want to get upset at Steve's definition there. Steve is correct, and I have proved that following mente all the way to mind and different aspects of the mind, it's not a suffix, as all of you are jumping out of your seats to claim.
Great. Well, and you know, I think just like you can't separate the occult from the intelligence agencies because the word means the same thing. Well, you can't separate government from mind control because that's
thank
what
you.
Doing.
Well, you know, and I've often made the argument that there is no difference between the occult and the intelligence community. That is the intelligence community. So I really appreciate you bringing that up. I'm glad that at least somebody else out there sees the same thing that I do.
Definitely. So just a few more definitions to get through, and then we can get really into the guts of this. But a coincidence is a striking occurrence of two or more events at one time, apparently by mere chance. And so if a coincidence happens, that's right. Coincidences happen in nature. If 2-3 coincidences happen, that's all right. But there's something that I consider to be a coincidence threshold. For example, if 10,000 coincidences happen, Maybe not all of those things are unrelated. Maybe at least one or two of them are
Steve,
related.
I've got to admit here, you just gave me a great idea. You know, in my last two articles in Theugen's What's in a Name and Spies in Academic Clothing, I make a whole joke out of the coincidence and serendipitously thing. What we should do is count up all of the serendipitous coincidental things that these Intel boys claim and figure out the mathematical possibility of this stuff, you know?
Well,
and,
I mean, absolutely, a coefficient of coincidence.
Yeah. Right, yeah, totally. I mean, this
well,
is,
coefficient.
You know, it's like, you know, and it was, and thanks to Dave McGowan, rest in peace, for bringing this to light in the first place, and Weird Scenes Inside the Canyon, he just kept coming up all these absurd coincidence stories, and he made a great point to bring it forth.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think, you know, let's count the coincidences as we go through this presentation. And when we get to the end of all the parts, we can look back and see how many coincidences there were. Was it all by chance? Was some of them
maybe,
related? Or were
maybe
they all,
we can put a coincidence counter right here at the bottom.
All right. Fantastic. Fantastic.
It'll be like up the old pop-up fallacy videos with the fallacy counter at the bottom.
Well, you can count the number of times I swear as well, and I can donate it to the swear jar. So a couple of definitions here that I thought were interesting, because I hadn't really thought about these aspects of these words before, but one aspect of culture is the controlled cultivation of living material in prepared nutrient media. So it's a term, culture is a term from biology. And then media is a term from biology as well. I mean, I'm not a biologist, so this is new to me, but the element which is the natural habitat of an organism, that's what media is. So you want to say something there?
Well, you know, I'm glad you brought that up about culture, because I was thinking the same thing over the last couple of weeks, and I see you and I are on the same page yet again. And, you know, media, the medium, what's his name, Marshall McLuhan, who wrote a book on the classical trivium promoting all the gunk, et cetera. Yeah, it's fantastic stuff.
The medium is the message. And then we also have medium in the sense of the occult psychic that's channeling interdimensional beings or whatever is giving them all their ideas.
Sure. Or at least that's what they want the audience to believe, you know, because that's where the power's at.
Yeah, the power's in that medium. And then the definition of magic from Crowley, I think is really, really good, which is the science and art of changing, of causing change to occur in conformity with the will. So I believe in magic, and I have practiced magic because I wanted something. And then I caused change to occur, and then I got it. For example, I wanted a car, and so I paid a deposit and went and got some finance from a bank. And then the car appeared. That was my will. It was, you know, by Crowley's definition, nobody can deny that.
I'm going to show a photograph of your car right here.
That's, I don't think that's necessary. But anyway.
Just giving you a hard time.
you know, but there's a lot of different definitions of magic, and in particular, there's lesser and greater black magic, which we can perhaps go into a little bit later on, but lesser black magic kind of can be understood in the same way as propaganda and psychological operations. So once again, we have the tie-in between mind control, the occult, and military intelligence. Conspiracy theory, I think most of, I'm sure your audience is very familiar with this, that the concept of conspiracy theory was actively promoted by the CIA to discredit people questioning the Warren Commission investigation to the Kennedy assassination. Here's the CIA document calling for them to use the term to discredit it. A conspiracy is a plan formulated in secret by two or more persons. So if you're a conspiracy theorist, you're someone who believes that sometimes people make plans together in private. So
you mean like a board of directors?
Exactly. So you know, I find it amazing that this phrase has even become derogatory in our society, because if you think conspiracies don't exist, There's something very, very wrong.
Well, no, that makes you a, coincidence theorist.
Coincidence theorist, yeah, there you go.
You know.
There are a couple other great quotes on this. I like Jim Maher saying, a conspiracy theorist is someone who questions known liars. And I think it's always good to do that. A conspiracy is nothing but a secret agreement of a number of men for the pursuance of policies which they dare not admit in public. Mark Twain, who is a Bohemian Grove guy. So, and I think this will be kind of the last definition for us now. We can move on. Fascism is a word that there are arguments over what it means, and there are multiple definitions. But the way I was taught in business school is fascism basically is when there's no line between the state and corporations, that when basically commercial businesses and the oligarchs have merged with government. And this chart here from March Against Monsanto kind of shows the revolving door between the United States government and Monsanto itself, all the way down to Hillary Clinton, who used to be their lawyer. So the result of this revolving door is where you live in this corporatocracy, where we look at all these different brands and we think that we have the illusion of choice. We walk down, it's amazing for me as a kid from New Zealand and Australia to go down the aisles at Walmart and how vast these places are and how many different kinds of Hannah Montana items can be purchased. But all of these brands end up in the hands of a few multinational conglomerates. And it's the same thing with information. In 1983, 90% of American media was controlled by 50 companies. By 2011, that was down to 6, and today it's down to 5 corporations. Sumner Redstone actually controls both Viacom and CBS. And this quote from Bernays, obviously you've used that. I think that your audience is very familiar with that. But yeah, the people ruling this country are the ones determining what the propaganda is. It's not the ones we're electing. We're electing people based on the dissemination of the propaganda. Where they meet, one of the places where they meet to discuss all this type of stuff is the Bilderberg Group, where you get an incredible intersection of tech companies, consumer companies, bank and finance companies, government think tanks, political parties, universities. And this meeting was founded in 1954, by the British and Dutch royal families, and it's still to this day very secret. It was denied for a long time. Now they say, yeah, it goes on, it happens, but it's not available to the public what it is they talk about. They meet every year, all of these oligarchs, and then amazing events seem to happen in the world that we all respond to.
I like how the graph makes a giant eye there.
Yeah, a giant eye in the middle watching us all, that's right. This is from a University of Zurich study, which basically they looked at financial data from a large number of companies, and they worked out that 80% of the world's GDP was in the hands of just over 1,300 companies, but 40% was controlled by 147 companies. And this graph here, the size shows the revenues. So there's basically a cluster of mega, mega corporations in the middle of this web, with very, very tight control over the world's GDP. And in fact, even amongst the 147, it comes down to 20 super connected companies. And I just recently showed this presentation to a friend of mine who's in the financial services industry and is very well aware of a lot of this stuff. But yeah, he just couldn't believe it, that if you look at this list of the 20 most connected companies in the world, and this is by interlocking directorships, basically is how they've measured it. There's only one actual company, which is Walmart. The other 19 are all financial services firms. Banks or investment banks. They don't do anything. They don't make anything. They just move paper around.
You know, I need to look up actual numbers. Who's the largest employer in the world, Walmart or the CIA? And I'm still not quite sure on the conclusion of that.
Yeah, I'm sure it'll be probably a group in India, like maybe the Indian Army or the trains. But look, the intelligence services are very large, and there are some of the three-letter agencies that we don't talk about very often that are also very large. But military intelligence is at least as big as civilian intelligence, if not bigger. And sharing data with all of the capabilities and maybe even in some cases less restrictions on their behavior. Well, these super connected companies, you can actually drill in further because if you look at the world's wealth, there's about $1.7 trillion invested in assets, and there's about $25 trillion invested in hedge funds or index funds that are affected by the primary indexes. And the indexes are set by basically just four companies that own and control all the world's major indexes that affect that other $25 trillion of wealth. And so that's the four companies listed down there. And these companies are always changing hands. It's like a bit of a shell game between who's behind them. They're really not particularly regulated. But what this shows, studied by University of Zurich, is really that the world is in the hands of the bankers. The world is run by bankers, and the bankers run the military, just like with my opening slide. But the network of networks goes beyond just the financial considerations. There's also intellectual networks. And this is a little graph here that I've pulled from a site called Tavistock Agenda. And I've added a couple of things in for Burning Man and Bohemian Grove, but it sort of shows how the nature of the world we live in is really kind of a complex web involving all of these different aspects and areas and organizations that touch on them all. It's not driven purely by money. It's driven by networking and connections and information spreading through these networks. And at the core of the networks that make the world work is the Stanford Research Institute, now known as SRI International. And above that, certainly I think behind that, the Tavistock Institute in the United Kingdom. And I think we could trace a lot of the countercultural stuff that we've had to deal with that came through the intelligence agencies via the Frankfurt School, via the Tavistock Institute, the Institutes of Advanced Study, then coming through SRI International, the RAND Corporation, the MITRE Corporation, to be sort of developed and weaponized in these military think tanks and then rolled out like everything else through the tech companies into the consumer applications. And yeah, the internet came from the Pentagon, and we're going to get into that a little bit more, but that's something that's extremely well known in the tech industry, but maybe not that widely known outside of it. And in the history of the tech industry, the internet, the personal computer, just about everything to do with computers, you find Stanford and you find SRI. Stanford has the Stanford Artificial Intelligence Lab, has the Stanford Linear Accelerator Center, the Palo Alto Research Center, known as Xerox PARC, and the Center for Advanced Studies in the Behavioral Sciences, which is a spin-off from the Institutes of Advanced Study at Princeton that did the Princeton Radio Project and the War of the World stuff. These groups have all played a fundamental role in the development of the World Wide Web and the modern tech world. We can point to them for the mouse, the Windows interface that enabled Apple and Microsoft, video games, Siri, networking, email, the internet, the web themselves. All of this stuff has come out of SRI. And with their global group of partners, sometimes Apple is the right choice to popularize the technology. Sometimes maybe it comes out of Kern and it goes to the academic world. Who gets to choose? It's a process that's invisible and without oversight. So Stanford Research Institute started in 1946, just after World War II. And then it was spun out as its own entity in 1970, renamed to SRI International in 1977. It has 2,100 employees and $540 million in revenues. It's a non-profit, and 63% of its revenue comes from Department of Defense. So this organization is primarily a defense contractor. They acquired a couple of thousand people from Sarnoff Corporation. That was RCA Laboratories, and that's an interesting area I'd like to do a little bit of further research into, the whole thing about David Sarnoff founding RCA. He was the telegraph operator for the Titanic. He happened to be in the office when the Titanic sank, got the scoop and was able to start a media empire, and the advanced laboratory of his media empire, which acquired the television patents, ended up inside SRI. SRI also designed Disneyland, which we'll talk about that a little bit later on as well. Taking a look at Stanford University, this is from Vice magazine last year, did a list of the top 100 most militarized schools in the United States. And in top secret, Stanford ranks number 76, which actually isn't that high. In national security funding, it ranks number 8, which is pretty high. If you look at the amount of funding, $89 million, and that's going for some stuff like post 9/11 Coalition for National Security Research, Air Force Office of Scientific Research, Strategic Command Deterrence and Assurance Academic Alliance, Department of Energy National Nuclear Security Administration Strategic Alliance, Lockheed Martin Materials and Thermal Science Center. So it's doing quite a lot of advanced research, but it's only number 8. 89 million, just remember that 540 million, you add that back up and you've got 630 million. Number one in the country, Johns Hopkins University, 649 million. So, in fact, you put Stanford together with SRI and suddenly their national security and top secret rank goes way the hell up.
Well, and of course, Johns Hopkins is where the psilocybin research was done with, what's his name, Griffiths that I've had on the show many years ago. And now it makes sense.
Yeah, Johns Hopkins has come up an enormous amount in my research. It's played a massive role in the evolution of computing. Perhaps we could talk about that another time. And I've pictured four guys on the slide here down the bottom. One is Johns Hopkins himself. He was a Quaker. He never married. His family had massive tobacco plantations full of slaves. Next to him is George Peabody, lifelong best buddies, also never married, never had children. George Peabody was actually a slave trader who became business partners with J.P. Morgan's father, and then became the financial front for the Rothschilds in London. He set up the first foundations, and what he did was the inspiration for Johns Hopkins, who set up the same type of foundation structure to endow this university when he died. The guy who created that for both of them is Daniel Coit Gilman. He was one of the founders of Skull and Bones and the Russell Trust at Yale University, also early president of Princeton, and he's the guy who set up the University of California system. So we find Skull and Bones at all of UC, Johns Hopkins, Yale, and Princeton, just for starters. Anyway, there's a fascinating story in there, and we'll have a look at some of the other militarized colleges later on in this presentation. But moving ahead to the 60s, basically what it looks like, it happened from Our research is that they spun out Esalen from Stanford, probably on the instructions of Aldous Huxley, certainly with an enormous amount of input and contribution from him. I mean, he ended up living there and then dying there. And after they set up Esalen, all of the 60s came about. And go ahead.
You don't have that JFK died the same day.
I do, yeah. Huxley died there. Wife injected him with LSD on Kennedy assassination day. And then,
in the blues, sorry.
Yeah, and then C.S. Lewis on the same day as well, and it was a very Illuminati Mason big day with the 11, 22, 63, which adds to 9.
And Jim Channon is another big one there. Now, I've heard that he was trying to reach out to me a couple times. I believe that he was under General Albert Stubblebine, who I interviewed on the show here 2 or 3 years ago. And so very interesting connection with him. And, of course, a lot of what Jim Channon created is part of, you know, obviously Army Intel or whatever, but and Men Who Stare at Goats, but all of that is spread out into society.
Yeah, and Lieutenant Colonel Jim Channon, he's really made no secret of how important Esalen was in his mission. It was basically, that was his office. That was where he was operating out of with the First Earth Battalion. And in fact, I have a little clip on that. Shall we go to that?
Sure.
Because I want to be respectful to the very courageous army that allowed me to do what I did, accepted what I had offered in the, you know, in the way it should be accepted. Like, okay, here's another way to look at something. And by the way, was courageous enough then to publish the material for commanders who could then go through it very much like the Whole Earth catalog, and pick and choose tools that would help, number one, soldiers be more survivable, awake, aware on the battlefield, which was coming to us then in 1978, and also to help soldiers function in teams. So this was not a secret. This was not a secret Pentagon mission. This was using a man who was stationed in California, me, to look in 1978 in what was going on in the alternative human potential, ancient Buddhist martial arts, complete bag of human technologies, which only because the New Age happened to be going on at the same time, was then somehow co-opted into all being New Age. Now, I totally appreciate the humor in seeing some combat veteran sitting in a hot tub at Esalen.
So we'll come back to Jim Channon in the next part of the, and talk about him in a little bit more detail. There's also some amazing links between Esalen and Star Trek. Fascinating stuff there on the internet about that if people want to delve down that rabbit hole. But I'll just put a picture at the bottom left there of an episode of Star Trek where they went to the pleasure planet called Risa, and the inhabitants of the pleasure planet were known as the Risalen. And Risa was famous for its steam pools just like Esalen. And there were many other inside joke type of things linking Star Trek with Esalen. Star Trek's also linked with the Presidio, that is the headquarters of the Intergalactic Federation in the whole Star Trek world. There was a whole bunch of stuff going on involving channeling and channeling the nine. And basically, there was a period where there were these nine principles, the ruling beings of Theosophy, who were calling the shots at Esalen.
Yeah, you're talking about Andrea Puhrich's team, and of course he was Army Intelligence, CIA, MK Ultra, all of that good stuff. Worked with Aldous Huxley as well.
Absolutely. So, yep, a lot of these type of people circling around. There's an ancient shamanic culture nearby at Esalen, where there are some cave paintings where people from the ancient tribes have painted their hands, the outlines of their hands, on the walls of the caves. And I think it's probably quite a popular place for occult rituals, would be my guess. I wouldn't be surprised if there's been some ayahuasca and DMT and things like that smoked in these caves. The other thing involving Esalen that's worth talking about is the changing images of man and the Aquarian conspiracy. Basically coming out of Stanford Research Institute again. It was a study looking at the future, envisioning some future scenarios and wondering what sort of humans we would need to create and engineer in the future to deal with these scenarios. And Esalen and the concepts of the New Age, the hippie revolution, were very, very tied in with this. In fact, Willis Harmon from Stanford Research Institute's assistant, Marilyn Ferguson? She wrote a book called The Aquarian Conspiracy, describing how 15 million hippies were now going to take over and infiltrate government and organizations. And this was the conspiracy of the age of Aquarius.
And of course, Willis Harmon was working with Al Hubbard, which I exposed in Spies in Academic Clothing. He's Esalen Institute, MK Ultra, also worked with the White House, as you said, Stanford Research Institute, Changing Images of Man 1 and 2, which you've got Joseph Campbell down there. Of course, Joseph Campbell was the leading mythologist on that. And when I was in New York 2 weeks ago, I also discovered that Campbell was studying at the Maverick there in Woodstock for several years. Of course, Aleister Crowley was not far away at Esopus Island, the Maverick Institute. Their motto was do what you want to. Of course, Crowley's was do what thou wilt. And so he also goes down into the Institute of Noetic Sciences, et cetera, and that just plunges into the world of intel. Of course, John D. Marks, that wrote The Search for the Manchurian Candidate, was under there. James Fadiman, whom I've exposed a number of times. All of these guys connect in from there.
And the Institute of Noetic Sciences has been doing experiments at Burning Man. Burning Man they do their company retreats at Esalen. There's a photo down there of the last one. Burning Man is very much based on this hero's journey framework of Joseph Campbell. I've created a couple of slides here just to take a look at that hero's journey and the different stages of it. But yeah, the concept of the monomyth, I mean, maybe you should describe this, Jan, because this is probably more your area of expertise than mine.
Oh, well, let's see. I haven't had a chance to look at this yet, but, Zach Bell or one of these guys could probably explain it even better than us, you know? I mean...
Yeah, well, look, I think they would explain it as this framework is a reference that you know, anyone can relate to. So as human beings, we're all on a journey, and we're on a journey of transformation and discovery. And in this journey, we move through all these various stages. And at the end of the journey, you know, we've learned a lot, and we've grown, and we've found new powers within ourselves that we didn't have, and we've made new friends that can help us. And, you know, our lives have been transformed from this journey. I mean, it all sounds very nice. Everyone would love to go on a journey. But the reality of this system is, it seems to me, really to set people up for mind control, because you're fooling their ego into thinking that they're a hero. And all they need to do to be heroic is to go on this journey and have some trials and tribulations.
Right. Navel gaze, and that's the idea, is to really get you caught into that so that you're not actually focused on your life, building a future, looking, creating a family and extended family to support yourself as you get older, you know, and it all shrinks that down so that you actually become reliant upon the state in a socialist system.
I think that's a great point about the family, and, If families were going through this hero's journey, it probably would be the individual members of the family are each going on their own hero's journey, which may overlap or whatever. But straight away inherent in that is this kind of separation and pulling away. And the other thing that strikes me from a mind control point of view is that you can kind of relate anything that happens in the world to one of these stages of this journey. So if you want to get people to do something, you frame it to them as, well, now we're at this stage and the problems you're suffering from are, you know, this stage here. Therefore, the only thing you need to do is go to the next stage and let me tell you a story with words in it that makes it seem like my idea is to bring you to the next stage. And you could absolutely apply that to everyone. And like lemmings, the people will be like, well, okay, you're telling me that I'm the hero and the next stage of my journey is this. Okay, I'll move along. And one of the interesting things that I notice, I'm not really particularly familiar with Joseph Campbell's work, but I'm certainly familiar with the end results, like Star Wars and every other Hollywood movie. And to me, the underlying theme seems to be always, it's out of the protagonist's control. Things are being done to you. Things are happening. You don't quite understand. You just kind of bumble along with it. And then someone will come out of the blue, a magical wizard, to help you.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, look, maybe life works out that way. Maybe it doesn't. But I don't see it as a particularly useful framework. But it's been taught to Department of Defense, to Burning Man, to Walmart, to everyone. And yeah, as you've found from this incredible research, we can draw a direct line from Joseph Campbell to Esopus Island to Aleister Crowley. It seems like these concepts didn't travel particularly far from these huge individuals.
Steve, that's just a coincidence that they were, you know, do what you want to and do what thou wilt, and that is soap is, I mean, that's just purely coincidental.
Ching, 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 that's number one. Let's put it up there. here's another way of looking at the hero's journey. And, you know, this one I counted, I think it has 12 steps. The previous one had 17. I found one on a military website with 10 steps. I mean, it seems like they can kind of play fast and loose with the steps. It doesn't really matter. The main thing is to get you on the snakes and ladders style game and they can move you from piece to piece.
Fantastic. That was a fantastic analogy.
Well, I mean, it looks a bit like snakes and ladders.
It really does. Well, that's why I laughed, because it was like, yeah, you're right. It does, you know.
Yeah, I mean, and look, maybe if we just go through this one quite quickly, we can apply it to Burning Man, like the call to adventure, like, yeah, we need to go away. Refusal of the call, like, oh, I don't want to go camping in the desert, oh, it's too hard. Supernatural aid, oh, I managed to get a ticket, someone gifted me a ticket, you know. Crossing the first threshold, you got to drive all the way out to the desert. Then the belly of the whale, you're in this dusty environment, it hits you, like day one, oh, it's so hard, how can I deal with it? Then you're on the road of trials, you know. Do you just give up or do you fight? Do you battle on? And then when you're trying to deal with it, maybe you meet some people. Look, I like this one has the atonement with the father and Luke, I am your father. You know, perhaps the father in the case of Burning Man is the Burning Man itself. You get the ultimate boon, which is to burn the man.
You know, no, let me just say, you know, people who haven't clued in to where we're going, why don't you give them a, you know, because they're probably wondering, what the heck does the last almost hour and a half have to do with Burning Man?
Yeah, well, look, what I'm trying to do is to place Burning Man in a broader historical context. So I don't think you can separate Burning Man from Silicon Valley. The two have become very much intertwined. And you can't separate Silicon Valley from the military because those two are very much intertwined. So, you know, what I'm trying to do is to kind of, you know, relay a general background of history of where we've come from and where Burning Man came from. And then I think perhaps at the end we can look and evaluate, does Burning Man fit? Does it fit with your research into the Grateful Dead and Esalen? Is it an extension of those type of things? Or is it just a series of coincidences?
Right.
How does this relate to Burning Man? I think Burning Man quite specifically have said that they see the hero's journey as a framework for running their organization, but also for burners to run their lives. And they see Burning Man as a tool of personal transformation. The Hero's Journey by Joseph Campbell is also a tool of personal transformation. The question is, who's doing the transforming, and is there any influence or shape in the transforming that comes from the methodology and from the content? So we can maybe explore that a little bit more. But I think for many of the burners, you know, they don't know a great deal about the 60s. So some of the stuff you've uncovered, like, you know, these primary documents from the Stanford Research Institute, there's basically the evidence is right here of how the 60s went down. Here's the document from Al Hubbard getting the LSD from Sandoz. Here's Willis Harmon saying, you know, drug use prevalent among student members of the New Left is not entirely undesigned. Some of it appears to be present as a deliberate weapon aimed at political change. If drug use is a deliberate weapon aimed at political change, then the obvious question is, well, who designed the weapon and who's employing it? And we know the answer to that. I don't know, we know.
Well, sure. And on this, okay, so for those who don't know, Al Hubbard was the Johnny Appleseed of LSD. He held exclusive rights for LSD from Sandoz Pharmaceuticals and sold LSD to the CIA, to SRI, to Canadian intelligence, etc. The document on the left side there is basically Willis Harriman saying that he wanted Al Hubbard, Special Agent Al Hubbard, to investigate this thing. It's like the fox investigating the hen house. They knew that they created the whole social movement and all of that, the counterculture. And then what they want to do is have Al Hubbard, who is an OSS agent as well, come in and then investigate the whole thing that he created. I mean, it's ridiculous. The one on the right side is, you know, even admits Dr. Hubbard is a commissioned state officer, experience in law enforcement, et cetera. And even in the photo on the bottom right there with Aldous Huxley and Gerald Hurd, of course, Aldous Huxley was the head of MKUltra, if not at minimum one of the key architects of it. But from my research, it heavily appears that Huxley was in charge of MKUltra and that Al Hubbard et al. Was working directly with him. But you can see all of them there. And for those who want more on this, I think these documents were what, under Al Hubbard in my brain database?
I've actually pulled them out of the incident archive, the memoryhole.org.
All right.
So anyway, the other document that's there, which is interesting, is it's a letter to the Department of the Army at the Presidio, confirming that basically Al Hubbard was in contact with them and sending documents to them on behalf of SRI. So I have about 1,400 references attached to this presentation, and the notes are about 80,000 words. So I will release all of that, but let's get this first episode out of the way. I might release it all at once rather than piece by piece when we get to the end. But certainly that information will be made available for your audience to you know, check these citations, follow everything back to original sources, do further research for yourself. So basically, these guys have created the 60s counterculture. You know, this slide is kind of encapsulating really a lot of the work that you've done and Joseph Atwell as well. So I probably don't need to describe every single one of these things, but one thing I'll mention that...
Well, you know, do it for a new audience, because this is going to be, a lot of burners are going to be finding this who haven't maybe seen my work before, so let's just go into it.
Okay, good point. So cybernetics is the scientific study of how people, animals, and machines control and communicate information. And it basically emerged around World War II, when one of the problems that they thought they could apply computers to was, how do you shoot a gun at a moving target? And they thought if the computer knew how fast the target was moving, it could anticipate where the gun had to fire to put the projectile ahead of the target so that they would collide. And this is not a precise mathematical calculation, because there are a number of different variables that have to come in, such as wind speed would be one. So they had to come up with an imprecise science to apply to a very precise thing, which is computing, which can be either one or zero. A card has a hole in the punch card, or it doesn't, and that's it. So they came up with this science of cybernetics. And basically, this thinking evolved after a series of conferences called the Macy Conferences, which began in 1941 and ran through to 1960. The Josiah H. Macy Foundation that put the conferences on has been linked to the CIA. It also received funding from the Ford Foundation, I believe the Rockefeller Foundation.
It was essentially the key organization behind the creation of the CIA's MKUltra program, in my estimation.
Yeah, I think that's right. And you find involved in these conferences many, many, many of the key players, you know, particularly Margaret Mead, Gregory
Bateson. And right.
Yeah, and you know, Eric Fromm from the Frankfurt School, a lot of the members of the Frankfurt School in Germany that really came up with these concepts of social engineering and cultural debasement for the purposes of population control, they were relocated from Germany to the United States before World War II broke out. And it really seems like they were plugged straight into these most advanced projects, such as the Institutes of Advanced Study, the one at Princeton that was the first one. They did the Princeton Radio Project, but you also find that Albert Einstein was pulled in, John von Neumann on the cybernetic side. I mean, there was a huge concentration of brain power. And then when the war broke out, basically that expanded to a number of different universities. And those universities were pulled together in collaboration with the military around these Macy conferences. There was also a committee called the Committee for National Morale that was formed, where they were really quite concerned around World War II with, you know, this new electronic technology, radio, as you made a point on the recent show, that here was a weapon that can, you know, get inside a locked door, you know, that, that no wall could keep this weapon out. And Hitler had just risen very rapidly to power and was menacing the world. And he'd used this technology of radio very, very effectively. He'd also used the relatively new technology of moving pictures and propaganda based on that very effectively. So when this group got together, they're like, you know, is Hitler going to mind control all of our people through radio? And then they said, well, what can we do? Maybe we need to do the same things that Hitler did.
We'll do it first.
Yeah, we need to get there before they do. And one of the things they decided to do was basically to...
It's always good to scapegoat Hitler whenever you're going to implement some devious plan.
Yeah, well, for these guys, this is happening in real time, I guess. But the idea that they came up with was that they would create their own personality called the democratic personality. And that would be a counter to the authoritarian personality, which had been developed from the Frankfurt School and had been employed by the Nazis. So the jackbooted Gestapo officer is our classic example of that.
Well, ironically, the Frankfurt School was, you know, Karl Marx, Sigmund Freud, Wilhelm Reich, Theodor Adorno, and these are the main guys, but they're all Jewish.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And most of them, funding via the Rockefeller Institutes and Foundations, maybe a few other little layers in between. But all these guys came across to the US, and many after the war, many Nazis were relocated to the US as part of Project Paperclip. We have the Huxleys involved with this group, and Aldous Huxley, of course, you know, his vision was to create painless concentration camps for the mind, to control entire societies with electronic, chemical, genetic, and social engineering. He wanted envisioned mass-produced models of human beings arranged in a scientific caste system based on the Hindu caste system. This would be created by the controlling oligarchy to get people to love their servitude. And in his original speech at Berkeley, It's hard to say. I think he says this would be the ultimate immalevolent revolution rather than the ultimate inmalevolent revolution. But it's sort of immaterial, whatever he said. He's describing the revolution of the future will not involve bloodshed. It'll be painless and without tears because people will be hypnotized and drugged into loving their servitude. And that's just the world we live in today. We can trace it back to these guys getting together. I've also got in the bottom right corner here just a little snippet from a Department of Defense Memo 77. Talk about MK Ultra was a successor project to MK Delta, established in April 53 and terminating sometime in the late 60s, probably after 1966. This program considered various means of controlling human behavior. Drugs were only one aspect of this activity. So, you know, we're not making this MK Ultra thing up. This is real. It involved drugs. It was the Department of Defense and the CIA and all these academic, you know, think tanks and organizations and some of the leading lights and names of society all collaborating together for the purpose of social engineering. How do we get people to love their electronic servitude?
Absolutely. And I've come to the exact same conclusions, and I fully agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, look, this slide is really just sort of a placeholder of your research, Jan, and people should really delve into this branches off in a number of different directions.
I really recommend people watch the 7-part series with Dr. Hans Utter and myself, Music, Mind Control, and Psychobiology. That will explain a lot of this.
And also your essay series as well is a great.
Yeah, on the website up on the top, if you click on GM pages and then click on Secret History of Magic Mushrooms, you'll see 5 different articles linked there that explain all of this in great detail.
So here's the changing images of man and you know, some of the personalities that I talked about, with the authoritarian personality, democratic personality. We can look and we can see some of these, you know, it's more than just costumes. These kind of are cultural archetypes. And these different little subcultures, you know, they dress in certain ways. They have words and language they use that's kind of unique to their group. Some of the personality types are violent and can be used for nefarious purposes that require muscle. You know, some are just docile and easy to manipulate. But is it just a coincidence that all these subcultures emerge and have such distinct, you know, looks and language? Or is there something behind it linking it together? And then why do so many of them kind of look different and the same, you know? What, like they have the native revival where people are going and buying these, you know, Indian-style headdresses and wearing them to festivals and things like that. And then you look at the festivals of the 60s and they were dressed like that as well.
Well, you know, and they're all uniforms, just like any military uniform or whatever. And people think that they're, you know, they put on their punk outfit or their Grateful Dead tie-dye or, you know, their burner with their day glow and their glow sticks and stuff. And they think that they are separate and independent when in actuality they're only putting on the uniform of that group or that military organization.
Yep, absolutely. And I think that we wouldn't want to live in a society of total anarchy. I think that, you know, in some cases, harmony and conformity is good. And, I think there's music that I like, and I like going to concerts. I like being around it. But, you know, one thing that I've really learned a lot from your research, what you've been able to teach me, is how they really did use this music to break society into different groups. Each group has a charismatic leader, and then through the repetition of lyrics and the images shown in the music videos or at the concerts, they can lead these groups in whatever different directions they want. And usually it's kind of the same direction, which is down, a downward spiral of debasement. It's not usually leading them in an uplifting, you know, positively transforming way.
Absolutely correct.
So one of the tools that they use to evolve man is this concept of the democratic surround. And there's a fantastic book by Stanford professor Fred Turner. He's done a lot of work looking at the evolution of the counterculture and the tech industry kind of from World War II to the present day. He doesn't really get into the conspiracy side of it or the role of the intelligence agencies behind all this stuff, although he does sort of touch on it a little bit. But this concept of the democratic surround has evolved, I guess, out of some of the thinking and ideas of Bauhaus. And some of the images shown here, one is the diagram of the field of vision by Herbert Beyer, where he's basically looked at how the eye takes in information. And this is the kind of thinking that's in a shopping mall today. You walk in and you're bombarded by images and colors and shapes. And so what do you look at first? And where the billboards are placed has been quite carefully, you know, worked out to make you see it, take the information in. But much of this thinking actually came out of the Committee on National Morale and Margaret Mead, and looking at how can we use images to shape people's personality. So they created an exhibition called The Road to Victory. It was in the Museum of Modern Art in New York, which is Rockefeller funded. In fact, I think Nelson Rockefeller described it as Mommy's Museum. And that was the first place they tried this out. It was a very successful exhibit. So about 80,000 people, about the size of a modern Burning Man, walked through this Road to Victory exhibition. And they saw images of Native Americans on posters that were larger than life. The photographs made these people look 15, 20 feet high, perhaps. And you know, we're used to seeing larger than life billboards today, but back in these times, no one had seen anything like that before, to see a photograph blown up above life size. So they walked in and their first reaction was probably awestruck at these bigger images. And then as they moved through the exhibition and looked at the different images, the goal was by the time they walked out the end, they felt positive. They felt connected to the people there that, yeah, they were American and they were proud and they were on the road to victory together. And it was very effective. And the polling of people coming out showed that it had the desired effect and probably exceeded the expectations of the planners. And so this then became a strategy that was used at things like the World's Fairs. And the bottom right corner here is a picture of IBM's Raymac computer. And it was taken to an exposition in Moscow where Russian citizens could come and, you know, sit down and you know, admire the ingenuity of America to create this computing technology. They could ask the computer a question, and the computer would then give them a response. And the computer was able to answer more than 4,000 questions. Now, it was probably a guy sitting, you know, on another computer behind the screens typing in the answers or whatever, but it impressed the Soviets with, wow, look at this clever artificial intelligence. But it also collected the questions for the Americans. So as well as delivering the message from the surround, observing how people reacted and bringing the data out of them, that was part of the value too. And I think out of this thinking, you can see how the Grateful Dead under Bear Elsley developed these outdoor shows, this massive wall of sound where you're immersed in the sound and the noise of the electric guitar once amplified. That's a very powerful kind of compelling noise, which humans hadn't really been exposed to that noise before. It was a new jarring noise. And in some ways, the fact that it was jarring and dissonant is what resonated with the youth and the counterculture vibe. And then the flashing lights and the smoke and all the immersive side of the entire environment of a music festival is an extension of this democratic surround. And the same way Burning Man is an immersive environment. When you go out there and you live in the city for a week, you can't escape it. And Gestalt is the concept of simply by ambiance and by the surroundings, you can influence people's thinking and deliver messages to them. And so in that sense, I see commonalities between a shopping mall, a rock concert, Burning Man, and an exhibition in an art gallery. They've all been designed to kind of make you feel something by being inside that space. And then just briefly to mention the Panopticon again.
Jeremy Bentham, yeah.
Yeah, and the concept was that one prison guard could sit in the middle and could see what was going on in every single prison cell from that position. And I bring it up because it's kind of similar to the way Burning Man is laid out. And also the Bauhaus ideas that are in these images here. One of them is of Tel Aviv, and the other one is a design for a city that I don't think was built, but by Le Corbusier. And the idea was that people would live in these very small, very standard boxy apartments, which they could then decorate their apartment however they wanted to personalize it on the inside. But then between the apartments would be these common areas where people would meet in the streets and the life of the city would be in the streets, which was kind of a shift away from the traditional village, hamlet, house-based way of living, and is much more like what urban city living is today. I have a quick clip of this as it relates to Burning Man. Let's go to that.
The city design has evolved over time, but the thing that's really interesting is, first of all, it's made with wooden stakes and survey flags. That's how we define the roads. But as you notice, these radial streets, oops, I can do it here too, that come down, they all look towards a man. So everybody's experience when they're at Burning Man, sort of a tickle in the back of their psyche, is, wow, I'm at Burning Man. You kind of can't forget it. So I better enjoy every moment. I better be immediate. I better be here. I better be present. And it just kind of sinks into who you are, of course, until it burns on Saturday night. And then that's a whole other story. But the psyche, the design of always feeling like you're part of something is extremely important. Additionally, when you get to the big circle in the middle, when you get inside this area right here, you automatically feel like you're part of it. You know that space was made for you, it was made for you to share, it was made for you to be a part of something else. And we just stole those designs from, you know, civilizations. You go to Italy, you go to Spain, you go to the Zocalos and the Piazzas, and there's a church in the middle and the space around. It's the same kind of thing. So you kind of, on a primal level, know that you're there and it's for you. So that it jump starts immediacy, it jump starts your ability to like get in and take part and see why you're there. It, your Why are you there? It makes you start to think.
Okay, then let's go to the next slide. So, again, this is back on your turf, Jan, and we've touched on some of these things just a second ago. But basically, you know, so much of the 60s was created in the San Francisco Bay Area. Also, a lot of it coming out of Southern California, and Dave McGowan's talked a lot about what was going on at Laurel Canyon with the Lookout Mountain facility. That really most, or a very, very large number of major figures of the 60s were tied to military and intelligence.
I just made a realization when you said Lookout Mountain and Laurel Canyon. This is too rich. Woodstock has Overlook Mountain.
Wow, really?
Really?
That's amazing. So the Grateful Dead, people should read your article, Manufacturing the Deadhead, to learn more about some of the ties there. Operation Midnight Climax was something the CIA ran in San Francisco and also in Greenwich Village, where they would use prostitutes to lure business people back to a house in North Beach.
George White, et cetera.
That's right. It was wired up with hidden cameras. And they would see what happened, because these were just acid tests, or they would get people in incriminating situations for blackmail purposes, which I think is more likely what happened. And literally the name of that was Operation Midnight Climax. The human being in Golden Gate Park was the gathering of the tribes. And this is the summer of love. This is kind of the epic moment of the 60s. This is when Timothy Leary stands up on the stage and says, tune in, turn on, drop out. Grateful Dead are playing.
And that saying apparently was developed by Marshall McLuhan as well.
Yeah, developed by McLuhan. They trotted out at a press conference in New York 6 months before. Classic example of weaponized anthropology. And the gathering of the tribes was sort of two tribes. On the one hand, coming out of UC Berkeley and Oakland and the East Bay was the new left, and they were being radicalized. So this is the Black Panthers. Saul Alinsky is there with his Rules for Radicals. Hillary Clinton's a junior lawyer studying under Alinsky. You have the Symbian Liberation Army that kidnapped Patty Hearst. And so basically they were pretty militant and angry, this Berkeley free speech movement. The riots were happening around the world. The other side of things, at Stanford, you have all of this advanced artificial intelligence research going on, and what became to be known as the new communalists. And these were these sort of techno-savvy hippies that wanted to use technology as a tool. It wasn't the enemy, the computers coming in to take over the world and humans would be just a number. Technology was a tool that could augment humans and make us better versions of ourselves. And this movement was very much spearheaded and led by Stuart Brand. And the gathering of the tribes was kind of to bring these two tribes together. And I think to sort of summarize an enormous amount of research that you've done, it's fair to say that basically they were using the free drugs and the hippie culture and the free sex and all of that to diffuse the violent side of the protest movement so that youthful rebellion could be channeled towards something that really would go nowhere and wouldn't threaten the big master plan such as the
Absolutely. Vietnam War. And before that, most of the protesters were in suits.
Right. So, yeah, they brought in the uniform, the culture, the words, the music, all of those things to change the image to be what they desired. And you know, this thing with the communes and the hippies, it's I was born in the 70s, but this stuff was very, very big in the 60s. And Fred Turner from Stanford has estimated that there were more than 10,000 communes in the U.S. at the height of the 60s. So that's a lot of LSD these people are popping.
Yeah, thanks to Al Hubbard.
Yeah, well, they can get it for free, Bear Owsley. There you go, have some for free.
Well, and, you know, you've got Millbrook up there, I just noticed, in one of those. But, of course, Millbrook was owned by Billy Mellon Hitchcock of the Mellon Banking Empire. He was funding a lot of the CIA's research, and, you know, that that's he directly funded Stanley Bear Owsley. And speaking of which, Owsley's widow lives in Woodstock.
Really?
Yeah.
Of course. Yeah, I mean, yeah, the other banking ties, you have the Warburg family tied in with Sandoz Pharmaceuticals. I think James Warburg was there with Hoffman. You have Gordon Wasson, of course, being
J.P. Morgan. And then he was a director of Sandoz Pharmaceuticals with Warburg as well.
Yeah, so you know, these bankers driving the military, by the time it trickles down to
but they're hippies, it can't be bad.
Yeah, it's nothing to do with war, it's hippies. And just on the Lookout Mountain, there's a picture there of Jared Leto. He actually bought the Lookout Mountain facility. That's now his house. And he's a burner. So the Crowleyan counterculture of the 60s was actually used to sell the personal computer. And basically computers were made by hippies and deadheads. And that that culture was used for the marketing as well. You see the image on the right there. We've got the famous Macintosh 1984 commercial. Everyone, the world was gray and the IBM people were wearing suits and working for Big Brother. And I think an Olympic hammer thrower threw a hammer through a window and everything turned into color. And the Macintosh came out. And then Apple used Timothy Leary to promote it. Also, we have Martin Luther King, John Lennon, Albert Einstein, Steve Jobs placing himself in that company. A lot of the people involved in the development of the PC were dropping acid. And there's a phenomenal book about that called What the Dormouse Said by John Markoff. I would highly recommend people reading that. But some of the things that we can trace to acid are all of the multimedia shows for the Grateful Dead, flashing lights that are a standard staple of any kind of musical performance today. We've got Douglas Engelbart, Bill English, and Alan Kay, who making the Windows interface, the mouse, and basically invented desktop publishing. They're doing the acid. You've got founders of Apple, Sun, Microsoft, Ampex, Steve Jobs, of course, also Steve Wozniak, who's a Freemason, and Timothy Leary moved basically once he was released from jail. He moved towards the world of computers and cyberspace and virtual reality, and he said that the PC was the LSD of the 1990s.
Oh, I was just going to add, if you read Leary's book, Confessions of a Dope Fiend, which, of course, I think is a takeoff of
Crowley,
yeah. It's pretty obvious in that book that the whole escape story out of San Luis Obispo prison was staged. And, of course, Leary wrote the psych exams for that prison. And, of course, he wrote the psych exams for the CIA. And then you have Joanna Harcourt Smith, who runs the Future Primitive podcast. She goes over to Algeria, takes him to Switzerland, another agent. I mean, it's like CIA, 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 you know.
Absolutely. Actually, I have a clip on that. Let's go to that.
Okay.
I give the CIA a total credit for sponsoring and initiating the entire consciousness movement, counterculture events of the 1960s.
Dr. Timothy Leary, the 1960s Johnny Appleseed of LSD.
On a PBS interview, Timothy Leary let his hair down and admitted that he was carrying on Satanist Aleister Crowley's work and that the 1960s is when the plan began to come to fruition.
Well, I've been an admirer of Aleister Crowley. I think that I'm carrying on much of the work that he started over 100 years ago, and I think the 60s themselves. You know, Crowley said he was in favor of finding your own self and do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law under love. It was a very powerful statement. I'm sorry he isn't around now to appreciate the glories that he started.
As Satan guided Crowley, Crowley declared that his writings were to be, quote, circulated among the young, end quote. Crowley predicted that America would pick up, quote, a few axioms on which a working majority can agree, a few dogmas which it could rally. Do What Thou Wilt, of course, became Do Your Own Thing, and If It Feels Good, Do It in the 1960s, Timothy Leary came up with a few of his own.
He looked out at that crowd and he said, turn on, tune in,
that's right,
and drop out.
Turn on, tune in, and drop out.
We're turned on, and we're tuned in, and we're very dropped out.
Turn on, tune in, and drop out.
Timothy Leary claimed that he came to the realization that he was to usher in Crowley's new age when he was using Crowley's tarot cards. Leary asked the question, who am I and what is my destiny? Leary claims that he then cut to the Ace of Discs. Robert Anton Wilson declared, this shows a large disc bearing the Greek letters to Megatherion, the great beast. Leary interpreted this to mean that he is Crowley reborn and is supposed to complete the work Crowley began.
Our undercover agents in Los Angeles were very cool about, and yet they did more in a very laid-back way. And it's never been as public as some of the other, the buses running around the country.
Yeah. Huxley was one of the first.
After we were fired from Harvard that fall, every major magazine came out with a cover story in Saturday Evening Post.
Yeah, that dangerous. Spread it.
Yeah, there were three different stories in Playboy. So that was, it was the firing from Harvard plus the fact that Henry Luce was somewhere always behind the scenes doing certain things. Plus, so many people have been involved in Los Angeles and so forth. But that was the first big
bomb. Tim was more responsible than anybody for
Tim,
that.
Wasn't it the calculated goal of FF to cause that kind of spreading?
Yeah. Well, I want to point out, though, that the picture, we all know here and now study pictures more than they do long columns. The particular picture of this article in Time Magazine attacking our research had scientific instrument called the experiential typewriter with all these dials, actually filled with socks, but that's all right. It had an incredibly beautiful young woman sitting taking the test, and it had standing behind her Alan Watts, a beautiful female Hindu guru named Gayatri Devi, and myself. Now the signal content of a picture like that was much more important than the little words that are being written by some clerk at Time Magazine. Well, I'll say one of the goals was to make the American people smarter, raise their intelligence. And I think the American people today are quantum jumps more sophisticated in exactly the general directions in which we all hope they would become more sophisticated about consciousness, about the nervous system, about the brain, about the options people have in creating their own realities, about self-actualization, self-indulgence, about pleasure being a self-reward as opposed to high reward. My God, pleasure is now the number one industry in this country. Recreational travel, entertainment, sensory indulgence. And my God, it's now, no question, that's our number one. Now, that was my goal.
So, next slide. Video games came out of SRI as well. So you might think that it's all fun and games, but actually these days the controllers that we use on the Xbox and PlayStation, that's what are being used by the military to control drones in the field. So kids are getting actual combat skills when they're sitting there with those controllers for hours a day playing these games. And many of the games have been developed originally by the military and used for training purposes. The original launch of video games was Stuart Brand again. That's a picture of him on the bottom left there. And he was writing in Rolling Stone in 1972. Rolling Stone was actually a newspaper back then, not a magazine. That's why these pages are a little yellow. But he's talking about Space War, where these hackers from MIT and SRI would get access to computer time after hours, and they made a video game where they could play against each other and try to blow things up. And so he profiled the first Space War Olympics, which was, interestingly, people playing video games with each other across a network, which was, pretty amazing for 1972. But that has now spun out of SRI and become a $100 billion a year industry in its own right, which I haven't looked lately, but I'm pretty sure that makes it bigger than Hollywood. So yet another example of technology coming out of this group, military research kind of funneled through the university and its think tanks. This is the internet. This is a map of the internet in 1977, and I just want to highlight a couple of things here. The top left is the very, very first thing the internet ever was. That's in 1969. And that was one server at UCLA. Obviously, it's not an internet if it's not a network between two things. So it became a network when it was connected to another server. And the very first server it was connected to was at SRI. We find the exact same thing as well with the World Wide Web. The very first server connected outside of CERN in Switzerland to the web was at SRI. This map here, you can see that almost all of the computers connected to the internet in 1977 are at military sites. I've highlighted a few of them. There's a whole cluster around Moffett Field, NASA Ames, Xerox PARC, the RAND Corporation's plugged in there. You've got Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Eglin Air Force Base, the Pentagon, the MITRE Corp. I believe there's a connection to London over there on the right. But this, there were some universities plugged in, but these were universities doing defense contracting research. The internet was almost entirely a military thing, and this is even at 8 years of age. Goes into the broader context of the evolution of Silicon Valley. And basically, we've ridden a number of big waves based on technological innovation. The first wave of Silicon Valley really was defense and military contracting. And if you look at this graph, in the mid-70s, there was about 1.2 million jobs in Silicon Valley, almost entirely defense. This is before electronic, you know, personal calculators came out, let alone the personal computer. And then I've put a couple of images in. We can see, you know, digital camera. I don't know if people remember those old clunky digital cameras or the first sort of flip-up laptops that came. You know, we had the iPod after 2000, followed shortly by the iPhone or Eddie up to the Google Glass. But you've noticed I've put the Burning Man logo in there. And you see really how early that was that Burning Man came out. Burning Man started just after the Apple Mac came out. So really, as long as we've had personal computers, we have also had Burning Man in Silicon Valley. The description to this slide down the bottom, you'll notice what one name keeps coming out, of course, which is SRI. So it didn't matter that we'd evolved away from, you know, the first wave being defense to now personal computer, internet, social media. SRI is still playing a massive, massive role in every innovation that comes out. The next big thing in Silicon Valley is venture capital. And yeah, there's a huge amount of information in this slide that, you know, perhaps people can peruse at their leisure later on. But I'd like to highlight a couple of things that are shown here, which one of them is the second graph in the middle, which is how much funding comes from venture capital versus angel funding, which is family and friends investing, I guess. There are some professional angel investors as well, but very early stage. You know, basically, if you have an idea, you go get angel funding. But these days, if you have an idea, you get crowdfunding. And that chart is just hockey sticking. It's taken over the angel funding, and it's on track very quickly to surpass venture capital funding. And that is going to be a seismic shift in the technology industry when people with ideas just go to the internet to crowdfund it rather than having to follow the traditional route of venture capital. So we're not too sure what that means for Silicon Valley yet, but Silicon Valley today isn't too worried. You know, there's an enormous amount of money. The average fund is $200 million, and there are 6,322 funds with $200 million plus of assets. The biggest one active right now has got $850 million. In 2014, there were about 1,300 venture capital exits. So these guys are coming out. They're making money. The average time to an IPO is 9.7 years. So You have to have deep pockets to play in this venture capital game. Peter Thiel is considered the most successful venture capital investor because he put a very early check into Facebook. But even for a guy like that, it took him 9 years until he could get his money back out. And so a lot of the money that goes into these funds, such as Matrix Partners China 3 or Meritech Capital Partners 5, we really don't know where that money came from. And by the time the fund cashes out, 20 years down the track, the job of piecing together where that money came from is going to be, you know, quite difficult for people. So we go back to the earlier slide of the shadow economy and these tech companies that have massive amounts of money sitting offshore. here's a diagram from a venture capital firm they put on the internet, which shows how you would structure a fund in the Cayman Islands that could invest in domestic US opportunities, but without having to pay tax or have the ownership structure of the fund visible to the United States authorities. And, you know, the world is awash in this venture capital. So much is getting spent. So much is fueling this tech boom. And where's all this money coming from? At the same time, all these tech companies have all this money, and what are they doing with it? And no one knows, and in the middle is a giant black box. So that's a quick summary
Is Saturn alien reference there, the black box in the center of it, or was it Mecca, or was it Black Rock? I can't remember. I'm getting confused.
It's the big black carver stone in the middle of it all. All right, we're nearly finished on this part. So there's a guy called Steve Blank has done a series called The Secret History of Silicon Valley, and I would highly recommend for anybody interested to look at his presentation. He's also got a YouTube where he goes through it, and he goes through this stuff in great detail. I'm going to try to just really fly through it to show some highlights here. But the first graph, the top left, the defense R&D budget, it shows California's share in red of America's defense R&D budget. This is the period 1953 to 1972. So sort of before the first wave of Silicon Valley, before the PCs. And you can see that California has really quite a small share of the national budget, but a significant share. Drilling further into California's share, how much of that went into Silicon Valley? That's the second slightly larger graph. And the green is how much is Silicon Valley. And then how much of that is venture capital is just a tiny, tiny, tiny blip. So up until 1972, venture capital was almost meaningless in Silicon Valley. It was really almost entirely military funding. And we have the rise of risk capital here. The first VC was VenRock, rock as in Rockefeller. And we have early IPO, HP, whose first customer was Disney. They went public in 1957. Ampex, Myron Stoleroff from the Ampex company was being regularly dosed with LSD. He was one of the very first MKUltra participants. And we got a bunch of these VC firms came out.
He was also working with MKUltra. Yeah, I mean, he wasn't just a participant in the studies, which he did also at Ampex, but he was also a core player of MKUltra.
So the military history of Silicon Valley, I'm just going to hit some quick highlight points here, one of which is that they've been making military craft here since 1854 when they established a naval base in Mare Island. More than 500 vessels were built in the Bay Area, including nuclear submarines. Hewlett-Packard was the first major Silicon Valley startup, and it spun out of Stanford. Basically, David Packard wrote for his university thesis. He designed a form of electronic oscillator that could make a pure tone. And this was pitched to the Disney Corporation, and Disney said, yep, we're going to have 8 of those for Fantasia. So Disney, in making Fantasia, the first feature-length animated movie, was getting extremely advanced, cutting-edge technology out of Stanford. For what purpose, I'm really not too sure, but that's what gave birth to HP. And for the early years of their life, they were a major, major military contractor. I believe they still are today. In World War II, the amount of losses of aircraft were just absolutely mind-blowing. The US lost nearly 53,000 planes operationally. Our total losses were 95,000, so I don't know if we lost a lot in shipping and transit, perhaps. The UK lost 42,000 planes, Germany 77,000, and Russia 106,000 planes. That's just so massive, these factories that were churning these aircraft out. And during World War II, they started developing technologies to track the planes like radar, and then they started developing countermeasures to fool the radar. And by the end of the war, the radar systems were being put on the planes themselves, as well as being ground-based. This led to a massive boom in Silicon Valley. The Harvard Radio Research Lab was being run by a guy called Fred Terman, who was out of Stanford. So he went back to Stanford after the war and said, look, I want to take the smartest guys from this radio research lab and set up at Stanford what the military has done with MIT, Caltech, Harvard, and Columbia, which is basically fund military R&D in place in the university to contribute to the war effort. And that was set up. He brought with him also a guy called William Shockley, who's considered the father of the semiconductor. And this guy was a hardcore, big-time eugenicist. And basically, these guys set up – Silicon Valley was initially known as Microwave Valley before the semiconductor boom even happened. There was a microwave boom. And, you know, there's a fascinating thing that I think doesn't occur to most people about technology, that the radio, laser – Wi-Fi, cell phone, radiation, like radiation therapy, the microwave, these are all variations of the same technology, which is radio. The R in laser refers to the radio. So this broadcast technology, you know, there are a million channels in the air around us right now, and we can't hear any of them, but we can hear all of them if we tune into the right frequency and resonant crystal pattern. It's quite fascinating technology to me, and you know it's evolved out of Silicon Valley. The other thing that I'll mention is from the military side. Project Poppy was the first satellite launch from the United States, and it was the Navy Research Laboratory and the National Reconnaissance Office. And what it was able to do was to identify ships at sea from radio and radar emissions. So this was a game-changing capability, and this was sort of developed in the early to mid-60s. Stanford University has a massive satellite dish, which you'll see if you drive past. That was developed for the CIA. They're heavily involved in the U-2 spy plane project. One of the things that's enabled Silicon Valley was Fred Terman basically pushed this idea that to spin technology out to license technology that had been developed at Stanford to another firm was incredibly easy. So they really facilitated that, and then they encouraged the graduate students to form companies and get access to funding, and then they encouraged professors to go and sit on the board. This has worked very effectively. Some recent examples were Sun Microsystems, which was the Stanford University network. They developed this networking and workstation technology internally, and they spun it out to a separate company. And the CTO of Sun was a guy called Andreas Bechtolsheim. He was the first investor in Google. And Google was another example of this thing. They were students at Stanford. Their professor, Terry Winograd, was advising them. He introduced them to this guy, Andy Bechtolsheim, who wrote the check and got them their funding. So Stanford's spinning these things out. The military, the government's coming in to pay for it. We've got Moffett Field down there, which used to be a Navy blimp base. This is now Google's aviation base next to their headquarters. They signed a 60-year lease on the site. The NASA Ames Research Center is also in Silicon Valley, 2,300 employees and nearly $1 billion annual budget. And then we've got the Jet Propulsion Laboratories, which is in Southern California, Pasadena, Caltech. But it was founded by Jack Parsons, who was a Stanford student. He also lived in the Bay Area. He worked at an explosives factory in Hercules.
And a big Crowleyite.
Absolute Crowleyite, hardcore occultist. At one time was picked to be Crowley's successor. So I've got five more slides.
All right.
We gave birth to the first trillion-dollar startup, which is Fairchild Semiconductor. And they have traced more than 2,000 companies in Silicon Valley that can track their origin to this one company, Fairchild, including Burning Man. Burning Man has a link going all the way back to Fairchild Semiconductor. The other thing that Steve Blank in his Secret History of Silicon Valley brings up is this concept of spook entrepreneurship and the role that the intelligence agencies have played in all of these tech companies. So I'll run through these quite quickly, and then I've provided links to all of the stories if people want to get more information. Oracle, the database company, they have 48.3% of the world's database market. It began as an internal CIA project. And Oracle was also the name of a popular counterculture magazine in San Francisco in the 60s. So calling that project Oracle was quite likely a reference to the counterculture. And when Larry Ellison spun Oracle out of the CIA into its own company, the CIA was the first customer for Oracle. IBM has their fingers in just about everything. During World War II, through a series of corporate machinations, they ended up supplying the Germans, the Russians, the British, and the Americans. I'm not sure about Japan. I wouldn't be surprised if they were supplying the Japanese as well. And the tattoos in the concentration camps of numbers on people's arms, that was so they could use IBM's barcode technology to automate processing large amounts of people. So World War II was a revolution in logistics, including human transportation and prisoner transportation, made possible because of IBM's punch card and automation technology. World War II had plenty of American companies trading with the enemy, including Standard Oil supplying Hitler with fuel. So the first Silicon Valley VC has kind of come from money that was made in war profiteering, trading with the enemy. Intel, Fairchild, Intel spun out of Fairchild. I mean, the whole name of it, Intel Inside. I mean, they sort of are, they love to put things in our face, these guys.
Yeah, I mean, that one's real obvious, too.
Yeah.
You know, lately they've been using a whole lot of satanic referencing in their commercials, et cetera, as well.
Right. They even, at a computer show a few years ago, they had a giant Burning Man-like effigy on their display stand. So these companies, you know, if you look at who their early customers were, they got very large government contracts, you know, probably military or an intelligence agency. And that's really what enabled the company to get started. Like if I need to raise $5 million from a venture capitalist and I have $10 million in orders from the government, it's going to be pretty easy for me to get that $5 million. And so that's the role that, you know, having a large partner plays in getting these things off the ground. Intel, Microsoft, Oracle, they all immediately did deals with IBM. And there are quite a few Bohemian Grove ties with IBM. Tom Watson Sr., John Akers, who was the chairman of IBM when Microsoft did their deal, he sat on the board of United Way with Bill Gates's mom. And so Bill Gates, IBM was looking for an operating system that would enable them to have a personal computer, but they were very concerned about being broken up by antitrust if they were to get in the personal computer business. And so Bill Gates delivered this operating system that let them have a horizontal model that many, many companies could offer their own computers, including IBM, but the underlying technology was this Intel architecture, this Microsoft operating system, and this incredibly fortuitous deal that, lucky for Bill Gates, his mom was on the board with John Akers, because it turned out that this is the most lucrative commercial deal that has ever been made in history, Microsoft royalties for the operating system inside the IBM PC. Moving on to Facebook, you find founder Mark Zuckerberg. He went to extremely elite prep school called Phillips Exeter. Stuart Brand is also a graduate of the same prep school. Then he went on and he was in a special program at Johns Hopkins called the Center for Talented Youth. Sergey Brin, the Google founder, also went through this program, and so did Lady Gaga. So it's perhaps no surprise that these talented youth go on to achieve great things, because it seems like they've been tapped by the system from an early age. Sean Parker, also, I guess, could be considered a Facebook founder, certainly a Facebook billionaire. When he was 16 years old, he was a hacker and he got caught by the FBI. And in doing that, he drew the attention of the CIA, who offered him an internship at 16. If you've seen the Facebook's movie, The Social Network, you know the famous story, which is that basically Zuckerberg had moved to Palo Alto and he was unloading his car, moving into a house. And Sean Parker happens to be strolling by with a drop-dead gorgeous girlfriend. And he recognizes him. He says, hey, aren't you? Go ahead.
That's serendipity number two. Ding.
Ding, ding. There's a coincidence. Yep. He says, yeah, hey, aren't you Mark Zuckerberg? And Zuckerberg's like, yeah, hey, you're Sean Parker. And so they get together. And Sean Parker, basically one of the first things he does is introduces Zuckerberg to Don Graham from the Washington Post. And Don Graham becomes Zuckerberg's mentor and advising him on deals and transactions. And the Washington Post is obviously very well known as a front end for Operation Mockingbird and with extremely deep ties to the CIA. It's now owned by Amazon.com's Jeff Bezos. He's a burner, and most of his products are named burning man-related themes like fire and Kindle and so on.
Book burning.
Book burning. So Bezos did a $600 million deal with the CIA to host some software on the Amazon cloud and then turned around the same time, spent $250 million to buy the Washington Post. So very interesting that Facebook is connected to that whole circle. And Bezos was actually also a very early investor in Google. We have another company called Palantir that, thanks to the Snowden revelations that came out, that this company has a thing called Prism software that basically is spying on all of our personal data and sharing that information between police and government and intelligence agencies. This one is called a mega unicorn. So a unicorn is a private company worth more than $1 billion, hasn't gone public yet. These mega unicorns, it's worth more than $20 billion. They just raised $880 million. We have another company worth talking about, InQtel, which is the venture capital fund of the CIA. They have a portfolio of more than 100 companies they've invested in. And for every dollar that they invest, it's matched by $9 of venture capital money. So a lot of quite popular technologies begin as ideas in the CIA that the CIA can then spin out and fund through this venture capital arm. Google is an example of that. Before Google got started, Sergey Brin was in regular meetings in a project where he was consulting to the CIA. This has been covered in amazing work by Nafees Ahmed, a journalist writing on a crowdsourced project. And I would really recommend people find Nafees' work if you just Google, Google the CIA and Google, and you'll probably find the story of how Interval Research, a think tank of Microsoft founder Paul Allen, came up with a lot of the early work that became Google, and it spun out of a not very well-known organization called the Highlands Group. That's almost like a tech bohemian grove. I think they seem to have their fingers in a lot of pies. Google is now the world's largest manufacturer of military robots, so it's not just about search anymore. Both Apple Mac and Microsoft Windows spun out of Xerox PARC. Tor, the encryption technology, almost everybody involved in that was from the Navy or the NSA. And holes in that system were recently used to bust the founder of the Silk Road, Ross Ulbricht. We've got Siri coming from DARPA. We've got the self-driving cars. That was a DARPA grand challenge. So up until 2007, no car had been able to drive itself through a fairly simple obstacle course. That was first completed when someone won the challenge. And then in 2015, Tesla just releases that as an overnight release. Suddenly we have self-driving cars. So yet another example of how the military sets this challenge. DARPA, the technology is developed for DARPA, and then one day just every consumer gets it through one of these Silicon Valley tech companies. And if you look at the DARPA grand challenges now, it's actual humanoid robots walking around, climbing over rubble, walking upstairs, opening doors and using tools.
When do these people that work and live in the Bay Area and Silicon Valley wake up and realize that they're creating their own military demise?
Yeah, well, I think that's really kind of the point of it. If you look at what would be the motivation to use LSD to create a counterculture of deadheads that stays close to the tech industry, and what would be the motivation to have like a Burning Man and have that very, very tied to the tech industry? I think one very possible motivation is, how do you get people to engineer their own demise? And the answer is distraction. You need a way to misdirect them and take their mind off it. Compartmentalization is one way. But if people are so caught up on being in the hero's journey and their own transformation and where they're going, they kind of can't see the big picture. They lose sight of context. And if you can't see the forest for the trees, it's easy to justify you're doing your little bit. You've come up with an amazing new way to spy on every human. But, you know, you feel good about yourself at night because you're also building a cool art car at Burning Man. And, you know, if people in your Burning Man camp knew that you were building spy technology, they might not like you, but they just know you as King Zos, the guy with the cool art car, so go take some acid with them and, you know, laugh about it and have a good time. And I don't know. That's one scenario, but there could be more to it than that as well. All right, let's wrap this up. These slides are from the Snowden revelations. And you see that the NSA have strategic partnerships. And the NSA's strategic partnerships are with all of the biggest tech companies. In fact, if you look at the chart of the largest tech firms and what they're worth, it's hard to find a very highly valuable Fortune 500 tech company that hasn't partnered with the NSA, that hasn't partnered with the government to share our data. And there's a little aerial map here of Moffett Field, which is where the Google campus is. It's also where the Yahoo campus is. And Microsoft has an office down there as well. It's also the location of the Army 7th Psychological Operations Division. But between Google, Yahoo, and Microsoft, that's pretty much search in the Western world outside of China, you know. That's kind of the whole thing. And so it's very interesting that they're there on this military base with NASA, with Lockheed Martin, with Northrop Grumman, and all these kind of guys. And these companies are forming strategic partnerships with the government, with the intelligence agencies. A bunch of different things combined here. This is also some stuff from the Snowden revelations, and they're looking at basically, this is how intelligence agencies get trained, and this is the areas of interest to intelligence agencies. And if you look at the graph in the middle there with the little humanoid figures, you'll see a couple of words that seem to pop up a lot in our research, Jan. Anthropology and psychology. Anthropology. And, you know, I never would have thought going into this research that intelligence agencies would have more than just the barest passing interest in anthropology. But it turns out that actually the anthropology maybe came first, and that's what created the CIA.
Well, and look at Gregory Bateson, one of the key founders of the CIA, was an at least his wife, Margaret Mead, was an anthropologist, and she was CIA. But yeah, I mean, they're all anthropologists. They're all psychologists, psychiatrists. They're all working with the CIA. They're all doing all this stuff. Yeah, I mean, this is the counterculture world of MK Ultra that the burners live in today.
Yeah, and it's all about manipulation. So how do we get the population into a state where they can be useful to us? How do we manipulate them to move in the direction we want them to do, but how do we extract value from them? And I've shared an example there from Carol Quigley's Anglo-American Establishment. I guess I'll read it out, but he's basically describing how secret societies can influence government policy. Says, by the interaction of these various branches on one another under the pretense that each branch was an autonomous power, the influence of each branch was increased through a process of mutual reinforcement. The unanimity among the various branches was believed by the outside world to be the result of the influence of a single truth, while really it was the result of the existence of a single group. So a statesman announces a policy. About the same time, the Royal Institute of International Affairs publishes a study, and Oxford Don publishes a volume on the subject through a publishing house that's connected to the group. And then the policy is subject to critical analysis in the newspapers. The two different books are reviewed by the newspapers, maybe compared to each other. And then there's an anonymous article circulated amongst the politicians saying, oh, look at this review of this book. Have you read it? Look at this article in the newspaper. They all seem to be pointing in the same thing, like, really, we need to do this. And the cumulative effect of such tactics, even if each tactical move influences only a small number of important people, is bound to be great. And this is how groupthink works, and this is how secret societies can influence people.
And if people want to know more about exactly how this works, I also recommend people, again, you know, we already referenced the article series, but this is part 5, Spies in Academic Clothing.
Excellent. So finally, for tonight at least, NASA has war plans. And not only does NASA have war plans, but they include psychological warfare and transhumanism. This is from a presentation made in 2001, and it's basically looking at what the future looks like to NASA. And many of the things that are described are happening absolutely today. And I'll draw your attention to the right-hand side, the highlights from page 55, where it says, what is apparently legal? So NASA's sitting there wondering, you know, in our war plans, what's the legal things that we can wage war with, and what are the illegal things that we have to do covertly, presumably? And what's legal is microwave, RF, anti-functional and anti-personnel weaponry, chemical, anti-functional weaponry, chemical, psychological effects by sensory organs, chemical personnel and capacitation. I mean, this is all MK Ultra right there. Right? This is, sure. Could be a list of sub-projects. Psywar and acoustic weaponry. Yeah. So if Silicon Valley is going to develop all of these types of devices, where are they going to test them? You know, and who are they going to test them on? It's like they need a large and compliant population who would voluntarily assume to take on risks of injury, maybe even death by participating in these experiments.
Burners.
Absolutely. So I think that in this introduction, I've kind of laid a bit of groundwork, and as we go through this, it might make a little bit more sense. But you know, if you were to look at Burning Man's website and you were to look at their list of employees, there's more than 100 employees. And if you go through and you say, well, you know, how many of them were really involved in the military? Well, in fact, there's only one. And so you think, what? Why am I talking about all of this stuff if there's only one person from the military in Burning Man? But this is why it's important to see the broader context that all of Silicon Valley is the military, and also the broader context that Silicon Valley has not just been creating technology, it has been creating culture and using these tools of the images of man and the democratic surround, as well as these electronic and chemical means, to create the culture it desires for the world it wants to build its products for. And I think as we get into this series, we'll drill a lot further down into exactly how that's been happening.
Excellent, Steve. Fantastic information. And I hope people have their eyes just about popping out right now with the realization of all this is. And definitely go back and study all of the mind control research that I've been exposing for the last 4 or 5 years as well, and incorporate all of that so that you understand it, and this will all make perfect sense if it's not already.
Yeah, and come check out burners.me. You can read, we've got more than 1,400 articles about Burning Man, all kinds of topics, and more than a few referencing Jan's work in Gnostic Media.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that. All right. Well, I think that's a wrap, Steve. You have anything else you want to add tonight?
No, it's been fun, Jan, and bye, everyone. I'm looking forward to the next one.
All right. Thanks, and take care.